I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting today from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. And thank you for watching, thank you for listening to Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guests today are two of the leaders in business development in our community. Leah Hargett is the president and CEO of the Minnesota Black Chamber of Commerce. Ravi Norman is president and CEO of Thor Construction. Both are extremely, extremely important organizations for our community. Leah, in part because she represents a wide spectrum of business owners and business interests as we develop a climate for business in Minnesota. Ravi Norman, participant in that, but also leading one of the largest, maybe the largest, black construction company in the country, Thor Construction. Ravi, Leah, thank you both for being here.
Thank you for having us.
Let me ask you first to give the elevator speech about who your company is, who your organization is. Leah, start with you.
Sure. We are a business association established in 2000 by a group of African American businesses, specifically to work with with African American owned businesses and businesses of African descent to help them to build and grow their businesses. That's primarily the reason why we exist. We provide services to those businesses that include small business lending. We have a loan fund, so it's business lending to business. We also have a business education calendar, so we provide business education to help develop our owners' knowledge and skill levels. And then we also do a number of other kinds of advocacy. We engage in a number of advocacy efforts.
Ravi, Thor Construction.
So Thor Construction was founded in 1980 by Richard Copeland. Through the years, we've been a construction firm, so a general contractor and construction manager that also self-performs structural concrete. We've also been a consulting firm really around economic development, community development, and entrepreneurial development in the construction industry. Recently, we've continued to build our value proposition to where we also have a sustainability and resiliency affiliate that kind of focuses in on energy consumption and a human-centric model to how the built environment can maximize people outcomes, absenteeism, productivity, innovation, things of that nature. And then underlyingly, we also are doing some work just around how do you deal with complex problems and make really sustainable decisions, what we like to call smart solutions. It's driving our built environment business, but I think it also impacts discussions like today around how do we approach a complex problem like sustainable and resilient African-American communities and trying to make a more vibrant state It can help in that process as well.
Let's jump in right there. How do you, I mean, you raised the question, and let's talk about how do we create an approach to complex problems. What are the complex problems? What is the history of economic development, black business opportunity and development in Twin Cities and probably across the country? What's the background that makes us have that question, first of all?
Well, so there's a lot into that discussion, and I always try to kind of go at the end of the day, it starts with kind of a values conversation first, Al. So, you know, I like to think about my own background. You know, born in Washington, D.C., from Trenton, New Jersey. Didn't know my father until I was 15 years old. You know, a lot of tough environment, conditions, and circumstances that I was growing up in. In fact, I think if people were to hear my profile of my childhood and ask them to close their eyes, they probably say, yeah, in their mind, boy, he doesn't have a good chance. His future's gonna be grim. I don't know where he'll end up. Well, today, you know, as you mentioned, I'm able to run one of the largest African-American-owned industrial service companies in the country. I've had success as an entrepreneur. I've been happily married for what's going on 19 years and three wonderful children. And so that profile holds up pretty well at 41 years old, which is my age. So I always try to talk about the value structure between those two points in time. Mm-hmm. What is the bridge between those two points in time? And I call it hope. So that's the first part of the value mechanism, Al, is how do we induce hope? And to me, there's a kind of three pillars to that from a value structure. Number one is about God. So an acknowledgement of a divine order, a belief in the supernatural, and clear definitions for the words luck, mercy, and grace. Secondly, it's about community as a value structure. And a good friend of mine and yours, Alfred Babington Johnson, tends to, I like his definition when he says, when people intentionally behave like they belong together. And through that intentionality, you get the manifestation of things like nurturing and love and investment and ensuring of the basic needs on what I call Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I'm sure people are familiar with that, physiological stuff and then safety and security. And so as we think about what does that look like through that intentionality, I think it creates an infrastructure for what I like to call sit, eat, grow, and this concept of enterprise value. And I'll talk to you about sit, eat, grow here in a second. And then third, the third part of it is this concept of individual will and responsibility. And that as an individual myself, I thought in five areas that were really the key to being able to maximize opportunity and have sustained success. One is about my own level of inspiration. So I have to be inspired. Two, I have to be aspirational. I have to dream big. Three, I have to be productive, putting forth the effort to work efficiently and effective. Four, I have to be innovative. So I have to have had to continuously embrace continuous improvement through perpetual learning. And sometimes learning as much in the setbacks as you do in the things that have been kind of the accolade. Mm-hmm. And then fifth is about resiliency and being able to endure shocks to the systems and having to kind of survive through some of the toughest conditions and circumstances. And to do that, I have found that this sit, eat, grow process to looking at life is critical. Mm-hmm. And it's about access, it's about process orientation, and it's about outcomes. So on an access basis, and I like to use acronyms, and I'm glad we're sitting at the table because, you know, I always attribute a lot of this to my grandmother, Al. I call her the great philosopher because she always had a way of making really complex things simple, right? So she would, and we use the table in my family to be a really important part of the discussion. And she'd say stuff like, boy, if you want to eat, you better be at the dinner table at dinner time. So this concept of having access to the table to be able to eat is critical. And I've used that as an analogy to markets and opportunities affiliated with markets as well. So that concept of being at the table. And so to get us to seat at the table, to sit at the table is an acronym. The S is show up. So this concept of proactively creating, comprehending, and pursuing opportunity has been a huge part of show up, proactively show up. I, invest in intangibles. So I learned a long time ago about this, invest in the power of your mind. It's the asset that cannot be taken from you other than by God himself through maybe dementia or Alzheimer's and or some chemical issue that might change your mindset. But invest in the power of your mind is the asset that keeps on giving. And invest in behavioral attributes. Things like being reliable, dependable, being likable will help you get a seat at the table. And T, be a good teammate. Because this concept of cooperative modeling and cooperative partnering you know, no person is really an island. And this concept of competition is actually a kind of a less form or less wiser form of intelligence than cooperation. So if you can show up, invest in the intangibles, and be a good teammate, you get access to the table. Once you get access to that table, it's about appropriation and allocation. So it's a process orientation now. So I talked to that about, that's your chance to eat. How can we eat when we're at the table? Well, E is efficiency. And for me, I have this, to me, this concept of, I hear people say time is money. I've often said, no, time is greater than money, because I haven't figured out how to make a minute different than a minute and an hour different than an hour. And when I spend it, it's a real linear process. When I spend it, it's gone. I've seen money sometimes be able to scale and be variable to time, not the other way around. So the truth of the matter is, time is greater than money and the key unit of exchange in our human interactions. Value your own time, and how you value others will be a part of the process. A is about accountability. So how can we establish key metrics, qualitatively and quantitative, about evaluating our own choices? T is about transparency. So looking at process and communications and reporting and getting transparent around both intents and information. If we do that, we will be able to eat at the table. And that leads to an outcome phase, which is about grow. And that means generate real opportunities for wealth. Generate real opportunities for wealth. And the first word in that is generate. And I want everyone to understand, especially my community of African Americans, Black folks, I want us to understand that, think about generative principles, because they will make you see yourself as an asset, because you'll be about what are you creating and what can you contribute, which
generative
is
principle.
Generative principles. That's the generate piece. Real opportunities. I am convinced
What is a generative principle? Tell me more about that.
So I think the generative principle is to see yourself as an asset, and that you have something you can generate or create or contribute to any circumstance. So even that's right.
Okay.
That's where the answer is. And then the real opportunity piece is about discernment. Discerning real opportunity from illusion. And I'm convinced that that's a big part of the problem, is sometimes the opportunities that seem like they're out there or that may be available are illusion. So how do you know if they're real? Three attributes. One, when the opportunity is disclosed to you in a time frame that you can capitalize on it. When the opportunity is disclosed to you in a time frame that you can capitalize on it, that makes it a real opportunity. Second part of discerning whether it's real or illusion. The granular criteria around how that particular opportunity is awarded and you can be selected in it, you have to fully comprehend. If you don't, then it's an illusion. It's not a real opportunity. Or you might get lucky by the grace of God to be able to get that opportunity to come to manifestation. So you have to be able to understand the granular level criteria. And then third, the granular level criteria and that assessment process has to be used and connected directly to investment and capacity building and the things that are supposed to be helping, whether it's human capital, financial capital, or whatever it is, towards that. If that's not occurring, then the ecosystem structure itself is an illusion for opportunity, not real. So real opportunities for what? Wealth. And wealth, yes, we're going to define it traditionally in the economic sense. So we're going to define it by the job and the income. We're going to define it by entrepreneurs and contracts and revenue and margin. No question we should. But I tell people what I've learned is that the financial indicators are lagging to the stewardship of the other assets of your humanity, your spirituality, your physical health, your emotional state, your mental health and state have to all also be getting looked at, evaluated, and continuous feedback around being a steward in those areas. Because there's actually causality from those four that end up in things like financial outcome, which I think is important. So a holistic definition of wealth: sit, eat, grow. If you do that sit, eat, grow, which is a principle basis, then we can get into programmatic conversation about what we need to do. And, you know, I'm sitting on places like the Greater MSP Board, as an example, which was put together with some of your top CEOs and your top representatives from the public sector, who have all kind of come together around creating a sustainable economic development strategy for the region. And that the region is then exporting that strategy out into a global marketplace and a global economy. So they've done a lot of work. We've done a lot of work in that organization around that strategy. And there's three pillars to that strategy.
Let's come back in a second. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Ravi Norman. Ravi, great instruction here. Thank you. And Leah Hargett. Ravi Norman is the president and CEO of Thor Construction. Leah Hargett, president and CEO of the Minnesota Black Chamber of Commerce. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Yeah. I'm Al McFarland. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland, a rich conversation about economic development, and it's about the principles, about the thinking, the thought, the process, right? Ravi, keep going, continue, because you're on a roll sort of laying out a grand vision. I think that's so important.
Yeah, no question. Thank you, Al. And, you know, I really just wanted to lay out a value and kind of principle basis. I would also add to that principle trust, belief, scale, efficiency and transparency, leveraged resources, and I think a private sector-led engagement, honestly, Al. I mean, I think governments, nonprofits have really been trying tirelessly to try and drive, you know, solving these complex problems. The private sector needs to lead more effectively, and I'm compelled to do so, as are some of my colleagues. And so when I think about it, in the tie to the greater MSP, and why I want to make that kind of private sector connection and tell people about that economic development model, has three pillars to it. Telling a better story about Minnesota as a whole out into a global economy, prioritizing talent, and inside of prioritizing talent, actually about 87% of survey respondents around this kind of talent thing in Minnesota have identified that the most immediate need is trying to attract professionals of color and retain professionals of color as a dynamic. And then third pillar is about building global sectors. And it's been in food and water and health and advanced manufacturing, IT, finance and insurance, and kind of business headquartering as the focus of those. So here's part of the problem with that connection of the private sector is how does it get down into our communities at a very organic level?
Right.
That's exactly right. And part of it is we needed to follow some of that blueprint and then have resources allocated to it. So first and foremost, the telling the story model. Telling the story is about intentional marketing strategy and investment. There needs to be an enhanced, well-funded marketing strategy and investment towards our communities, mm-hmm. in my opinion.
And to me, that means engaging resources like Insight News, this
no
program,
question.
And others.
That's
and
right.
Others, right.
No question. And doing it with the purpose, though, of, remember I said, the first two parts of inspiration and aspiration. So how do we create that sense of purpose and ambition where we can get people kind of just invigorated with this concept of opportunity of I'm inspired, what's coming from within, and I can be aspirational to dream? Because I see a lot of investment in the operational structure right now around, like, let's create a better map, let's create pathways, let's maybe even try to get a robust training ecosystem that can be synchronized. What we're missing still, though, is how do we inspire the people? How do we inspire young folks? How do we get them to dream big? That's an intentional marketing model. And so I say there's some problems in the marketing model right now. In the current story, there's some problems. It starts with a language problem. This concept of reducing disparities is terrible language. Why? Because there's nothing on the end of it that induces inspiration or aspiration. On one side of that equation, I think there are, from the majority community, folks who, when they're being really honest, feel like, I've earned what I've got, and I don't want to feel bad about the fact that I've got it. That's the one end of the disparity underlying tone, I think. And then secondly, this concept of making African Americans and people of color feel like we're always a deficit or a liability, or that we need to be helped and we're not good and we don't meet a standard, creates hopelessness, not inspiration and aspiration. So let's change the language. Let's stop with reducing the disparities. Let's start with maximizing opportunity and creating sustained value. How about those as language mechanisms that everybody on the marketing tip says that's what we're gonna try to identify? So the first part is about language. Secondly, I think that there needs to be some really, you know, there used to be hard to get to assessing where people really are and where they need to be directly from their voices. Why, as you know, Al, you know, it's the transaction cost can be too high. Well, guess what? Technologies and other mediums, digital mediums, now allow transaction costs and scalability to be much lower in terms than what they used to be. So let's get direct information. Why don't we look at, when we talked about the holistic sense of wealth, let's go into these households and give them a voice about where they are spiritually, physically, mentally, emotionally, financially, and what they dream to want to do in those areas. Let's get that data and information and get it integrated into a platform for people who are over here making top-down decisions about money allocations and programmatic things and what should we be doing. Let's get that baseline assessment work done. Let's use North Points and the NASs and the churches to get that information, which I think is rich and can be there. Third, this concept of deep and nuanced stories. I don't see these platforms that are creating real stories about to help the aspirational model. I mean, there was a great TPT thing done on Richard some years ago by Mita. That's about the only one I've really seen of any real detail and nuance around stories. But there's a ton of successful things that have happened with black entrepreneurs or black intrapreneurs working inside the corporate environment. I know of a lot of them. They're my friends. Black community pillars like yourself. I mean, let's do deep, nuanced stories about them. Why? Because once we have those stories, that's the things that connect to people. When we're talking about people who are feeling hopeless, they need to connect that you've dealt with my same plight, and you've made certain key decisions or resource allocations to get to a different place. So there is you can do it. It's great to see Obama as a president because that was the hope. But we can do that at a really regional level here with some success stories. So I like to see those deep, nuanced stories get done. People in the marketing, again, committing to that. And then finally, this concept of power of 10 that I call it, which is our communities, we are assets. We need to start seeing our financial assets too. You know, Leon Sullivan in 1962 at the OICs had a 1036 plan that he had made happen in Philadelphia. $10 a month for 36 months. I'm telling you that people all throughout the what we call poor communities of African Americans, we can get to $10 a month. I'm telling you, I've done it in my own household where we found $974.16 a month in families that made less than $15,000. Back out east where I live. So I know that analysis can be done and show you can get $10 in 36 months. And let's start contributing that towards our own monetization models and concepts of self-sufficiency and aggregation. I've also seen it in small business. As you know, Leah, we did an analysis of 50,000 contractors that were under $1 million in revenue and under 10 employees. Found out that 27,600 websites actually existed that people have been investing up to $2,127 a year over 5 years. $10,635. And guess what? 99.6% of them had no idea if it was effective in what they were trying to accomplish, which was generating revenue off of it. So think about that. Take 27,600 times $2,127. I'll wait while you do the quick math, right? I mean, that ultimately gets to a place where we're talking about just under $60 million. $60 million, that's going down the drain, not even getting the return. So my point is there's a lack of stewardship at the base because people are always telling them to go look up and never see their own assets that could be aggregated in a way to create some power. So that's just a marketing issue. There's a Make It MSP platform. Are you familiar with it, Al? That has been released. That's about talent. It's the major talent exchange that's trying to move forward from the greater MSP. You know, I went to the portal the other day, and frankly, in my own organization, I've said to them, we have to change. If we want to attract professionals of color, then we have to show some professionals of color. We have to have some stories we maybe need our own customized portal as part of that model in order to be able to start really saying we're serious with investing in that scenario. Progressive Baptist Church, as you know,
What was the response if you raised the question about changing the portal?
It's just getting done now. Oh,
they're doing
it. So give me, I would say 30 days now to come back and kind of tell you that I've tried to galvanize. I have some of my colleagues I'll be talking to actually next week about some of the things. Progressive has their historically black college and university trip. Been doing it for a decade, as you know, and have over 400 some African Americans have come through it to build pipeline into the historically black colleges and universities. It's not getting enough support from the private sector. We could be saying, hey, it's about building black talent and pipeline anyway. Let's invest in something like that to give, so he doesn't have to worry about how he funds that. Mm-hmm. And it would create some loyalty mechanisms at the historically black colleges and universities who are underfunded. I mean, what an opportunity in a lot of ways when I see that. I mean, and finally, what about a regional mentor protege program? You know, it's great that we're seeing a kind of diverse from the other way in terms of a lot of white folks are participating in the fourth precincts model. I mean, the warm houses and say, okay, great. Let's do that same model around business mentoring and protégéing and entrepreneurial endeavor and just building relationship with, because there are a lot of successful people here in Minnesota. It's just that how connected are they at a real level, a real relational level with a mentee who might be in North Minneapolis and be able to kind of inspire them with some concepts of how can we really build relationship and move forward. I think there's a vast opportunity to do that. And then finally, around building global sectors, which is a business, true business endeavor. And to me, that's about, I think I said a little bit about it before, but one, we gotta really make people understand the economic value of diversity. It is not an altruism play. It is a really, not only now is it a core business priority, or should be, I think it's about sustainable supply chains. You are going to have greater reliance on diverse communities in a workforce and talent shortage model and in a demographic shift model, that these are going to be where your business owners are going to come from, at least American businesses based on the demographic. So your supply chains, to be sustainable, if they're going to have American-made product and American-made utilization, no question we have to be doing that. Secondly, it's about, let's change the disclosure framework around opportunity. You know, let's make the timeliness of that be much more real time and be much more projected out over a period of time that would induce capacity building to be much more. So you can have a rolling opportunity schedule as an example. So there's going to be these global cluster groups that are going to come out of, I would assume, out of the greater MSP work around food and the water and the industries we've already identified. Those cluster groups are going to know that there's going to be opportunities in their companies that they're going to be doing their supply chains and procurement models off of. Let's get that information put into a timely portfolio of opportunities on a rolling basis. Let's not make it just 15 or 30 days before an RFP process. Let's try to get it out there for a rolling schedule. That's a year long, maybe. That's right. So it gives more time for people to mobilize. And then once that's there, not only the opportunity on time, let's make those opportunities get down into really granular levels around what are the criteria. And let's think about what that criteria looks like. And then our folks can be assessed against that criteria. We're not asking you to change the criteria, but just make the granular transparency of what it means to get selected. And sometimes that's a deep and nuanced model. Can't just necessarily be surface level attributes. You may have to go deep and to get to the real granularity. And then when you have that, you can do efficient development modeling. Because now the capacity building world, which is where a lot of government dollars and nonprofits are trying to work, can now be connected to that granular level assessment, which is the foundation of development. So we can get really specific around capacity building endeavors and investment towards an outcome that are tied in these global sectors that have already been identified. I mean, let's make that. And there are systems out there and institutions like the Chamber and MEDA and others who can help support that initiative. To me, now we're getting serious about the engagement and interacting.
You know, I think we're at a watershed moment. I think things like the protest in North Minneapolis, the calling of attention to the income gap, and the ability to communicate these problems broadly and instantly so that they can't be swept under the rug, ignored, they can't be responded to by language that says, oh, I didn't know.
Yeah.
I think there's a greater accountability. What do you see right now in terms of this being a watershed moment? My sense is that things are going to change, and they're going to change right now in a graphic and drastic way. Do you feel the same way?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's going to be a watershed moment either because we haven't addressed it and it's going to blow up and it's going to turn into something that none of us, I think, want, that could put a black eye on what a great region we have. Or we can all get really proactive around trying to think about this complex problem and get really comprehensive solutions and innovative solutions to try new kind of ideologies, new methodologies to trying to deal with a complex problem, where people are trying to make a science out of good decisions, and I think getting everyone at the table. It's a watershed moment where I think people are incented to do so, where people will be at the table and are looking for solution. So I want to take this time to say, I think I have some innovative solutions. I think I have some comprehensive planning that can be done. It's not going to be me alone. It's going to be working in a big collaboration of legacy institutions, new institutions that are ready to really take this on. Because a lot of us, to your point, have been working on this in very disparate ways, but it's time to come together in kind of a one system vision around attacking this issue, because I think it's the burning platform in our region.
I'm Al McFarlane. You're listening to and watching Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Ravi Norman, CEO, president of the Thor Construction Company. And we're going to hear more in the next segment from my guest, Leah Hargett, who's CEO and president of Minnesota Black Chamber of Commerce. Ravi, thank you so much. You've got to leave. Leah and I are going to continue the conversation.
But
thank you.
We're in good hands.
I know that I am. Thank you, friend.
Thank you.
All right. Take care.
I'll see you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. I want to continue this program with my guest, Leah Hargett. Leah Hargett is the president and CEO of the Minnesota Black Chamber of Commerce. That was a great conversation with Brother Ravi Norman, but it sets the stage for us to go deeper and to explore the practical application of the principles, the challenges with the number of black businesses that you serve. How many members are there of the Black Chamber of Commerce, first of all?
That's interesting. Interesting question, and there's a, I want to dive into that too. But I'll give you the numbers. We have a total of 50 paid members, but there are 12,000 African American-owned businesses registered in the state of Minnesota.
Okay.
So we, as a Chamber of Commerce, and as a Chamber of Commerce specifically focused on this demographic, we represent that full, the full diaspora in relation to those numbers. So what's interesting about what Ravi was talking about and the numbers is that because of our current economic situation, and I don't want to say disparities, because we want to get away from some of that language, but let's talk about that. Mm-hmm. That impacts our ability as a Chamber of Commerce to be able to say to you that we've got 12,000 members, because our members have to pick and choose whether or not they're going to put food on the table every day versus have supporting a Black Chamber of Commerce, which directly can support their businesses, help their businesses to grow. They still have to make those kinds of choices not to support a Chamber of Commerce. And therein lies part of the problem for us as well as a community in terms of our businesses and our businesses being the economic engine that they can be to help address our employment gap, to shorten or to get rid of our employment gap, but also to locate in our communities, change our communities, and so forth. Mm-hmm. So
how do you plan to address that? What do you do? What are the mechanisms for changing that dynamic?
Yeah, well, it's complicated. There's a lot of things to do. One of them is to bring forward our own solutions, and that's what Ravi is articulating. And that's what was so exciting about the exchange between you and Ravi. That conversation was so moving for me, because here's a great example of what it's going to take for us to change our trajectory, is that we have to stop looking for somebody else to come and deliver us. We have to stop looking for somebody else to have the solution, the government, the city, whatever. We're capable of identifying what our needs are and then putting that together, articulating strategies, and then implementing those strategies. Our job is to do that as well. So what Ravi is describing and what he is doing for all of us is he's setting an example for us all that we have the ability to change the way that our community looks in the next 5, 10, 100 years. One of the other things that we're doing directly as a Chamber of Commerce in conjunction with what Ravi is talking about is we're looking at a new concept around building black-owned businesses, specifically African-American-owned businesses, and we call it Keeping It 100. We're looking to try and build 100 new businesses, African-American-owned businesses, in 100 months.
Okay.
And the way in which, and right now it's still in a concept phase, but that concept is now being studied. We have a group of graduate students that are doing a feasibility analysis, and with the hope that we will have a business plan completed at the end of January of this year. So we're looking to move this concept forward. And the concept, the elements of the concept would be to identify or to create what we call an entrepreneurial academy. And within that academy, you would have individuals that have aspirations to become entrepreneurs as well as micro business owners and other small business owners that would be served through business education, through mentoring They would be a part of the Black Chamber of Commerce, which, you know, once you start your business, once you're in your business, you need to grow your business. One of the ways to do it is networking. Mm-hmm. That's what the Chamber of Commerce helps you to do. Access to capital, access to information. That's what the Chamber does. The Chamber is a clearinghouse for information. We also run our own loan program. We also partner with some of your prior guests, NDC, MITA. We partner with them on our loan program. So this Entrepreneurial Academy will be that environment in which entrepreneurs will be able to come to and will be able to identify where they are in their conceptual, at their conceptual point in their business venture. We'll be able to also talk to them about growth industries. So when Ravi talks about those growth industries, we're going to connect this strategy with the regional strategy, with the national strategy, so that we can start getting our businesses to start thinking about establishing businesses, growing businesses in these growth sectors, that, and then teaching them how to, or giving them the access to their ability to create scale around that. Because that way, we're going to really be able to change the trajectory within our community. And so it's more of a generational wealth strategy that we want to engage. It requires collaboration. So we're looking at partners in order to make this venture happen. So NEON is actually one of the key partners that we're looking at here in North Minneapolis. MITA is a key partner that we're looking to try and engage. We will be doing the same with other partners that we currently have relationships with. This academy will be both a destination and it will be virtual. Okay. So it's going to be what it needs to be to reach the people so that we'll be able to be impactful. In addition to the academy, the 100 by 100 also has a strategy around investment. So we're looking to create an investment club so that all of the principles around investment are what we're going to really structure it around. We're going to actually build equity fund.
Mm-hmm. And
we got to teach people. Exactly. So all of that's going to be a part of it. We're going to bring industry in at every juncture so that we have subject matter experts involved as well. In addition to that, we're also talking about establishing an innovation lab. Mm-hmm. One of the things that NEON is doing right now is exactly that. They've created a workspace across the hall from where they currently operate in Dr. Williams Building.
Right, on Broadway.
They actually are going to cut the ribbon, I believe, in January. So it's right around the corner. But this is space for entrepreneurs to not only work, but be around other like-minded individuals, for them to all learn from one another. So a lot of peer-to-peer learning, that sort of thing. What we're doing is connecting with NEON on their and their space. And we're going to offer that space to our members as well. We're going to be able to also bring our knowledge and our programs to the space as well. So we're and we're looking at now establishing a business roundtable, because we tend to be small businesses, one, two-person shops. We can't get out. Our owners can't get out to take advantage of business education, so we're going to bring it to them.
Sure.
So it's going to be online, it's going to be in person, it's going to be where it needs to be, when it needs to be. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the things that we're working on right now.
All of this adds up to me, Leah, to the idea of trying to change our community's mind about
yes.
who we are as entrepreneurs and who we are as participants in the business equation.
Mm-hmm.
Too often, I think, particularly in the last generation or two, we've maximized our capacity to be excellent consumers.
Yes.
And we're perceived as, and we're treasured as consumers. The world knows if you want to get rich, come to a Black community
mm-hmm.
and pitch your tent
mm-hmm.
and stay there and work hard, you'll get rich.
Yeah, we're a $1 trillion market.
Yeah, and so
consumer market.
There's this dichotomy, there's this contradiction, this paradox that on the one hand, we say and we experience, and the numbers indicate the poverty level, the gap in income, the gap in wealth that is real
mm-hmm.
on the one hand. On the other hand, even so, there's still a substantial amount of revenue flowing through our hands, our communities. Yes, there are some people, and yes, there's a middle class that may be a little better off, And yes, there are a lot of people who are struggling with incomes of under $27,000 a year, but everybody is eating. Everybody is wearing clothes. Everybody's taking a bus, driving a car, buying gas. Everybody's doing things that are the essential things that sustain and maintain life. And all of that has a price tag, has revenue associated with it. And so I think that people see our community as a place where people haven't discovered yet how to capture their own wealth by serving themselves. And others are gladly willing to serve us and to enrich themselves by doing that. That's not to criticize them. Opportunity is opportunity. And those who see it are the ones who take it. Our job, I believe, yours and mine, is to both encourage our people to see ourselves and our opportunities differently, to recognize them, but also to develop the capacity to engage the opportunity to provide service to our people and to make money in the process, and to make the money in a way that is appropriate, business-like, and successful, that grows wealth for the family and the individual. I love the idea that you're saying you're going to provide these services, because the services you're talking about will be ones that bring value to those members, and that'll be growing your membership base. But what about this question of how our community sees business? What have you observed? And do you see that changing? Is there a need to change? What's your thought? And think about that in the context of your and my memory of a generation or two before, where there was a more self-reliant and more autonomous community, because we didn't have the freeway dividing us, right? And we had segregation compelling us to be with each other. Freeways destroying businesses, resources, homes, and then the ability to do business outside of the neighborhood have had an impact on our business presence. What do you think?
You know, I think that a big part of what we need to do, or what we're trying to do, is to build trust and to also to get us to all see ourselves as assets. When we start doing that, I think then we can begin to start really seeing a difference in how we all engage with one another. So it's not just about, for the Chamber of Commerce, it can't just be about creating 100 new businesses, but it's also about really trying to work on our, you and I, our perceptions of one another, putting the positive stories out there, showing examples of us working together. We're collaborating, we're business partners. I buy from you, you buy from me. The Chamber does that all the time in terms of, and it can always do better. We've got limited resources, but the resources we do have, we intentionally spend that money with Black-owned businesses. So we not only, you know, preach it, but we walk the talk, if you will. So I think that every time when we do those kinds of things, and then we are deliberate and we control our own messages, and we deliberately put the public relations out there, we put the marketing around it to say, look, this is what we're doing, then that starts to be, those start to be examples. We already are role models to our own people, but that starts to really inspire a community, and then it starts to change the community. Back in 2009, when I started, when I became the chairman of the chamber, there were some challenges that we had. We had an image that really was that, you know, we weren't quite a serious chamber of commerce, that we were more into more social kinds of networking. They didn't, everyone didn't necessarily understand that that is a key aspect of business. But we had to get back to basics. And so we've done that. And I think that we have now gotten ourselves to a place where we can begin to start being leaders ourselves, a great example of what's possible. When we talk about what we're trying to do here with this innovation strategy, with this Entrepreneurial Academy and the lab and the investment club, remember, it's going to be business people primarily leading other business people or aspiring business people. So that example is going to be very powerful too. And I think that that's what we had, you know, 50 years ago, 60 years ago, through segregation. We saw each other every day running businesses, making decisions. We went and we actually experienced the quality service that we can provide, the cost, everything. But those times have changed because of integration. There's a lot of other reasons why, you know, that has changed for us as a people. But we have to get back to that. It's like any other people. White people, brown people, yellow people, you have to lead yourself. Mm-hmm. You have to lead yourself. And when you do that, you see a complete different result. So that's what, it's our time to do that. So I think that that's what's going on right now is going to lead us back to that. With young people, what I've found talking to young entrepreneurs, I don't have to convince them to buy black.
They know it.
They know
That's
it.
That's the power of the hip-hop generation.
Yes.
And the philosophy that guides their identifying themselves as hip-hop is a philosophy that is based on the hustle, the grind, you know, the entrepreneurship. So they understand, mm-hmm. and they're okay. They're willing to do the work.
Yes.
And they think the work is really the reason that they exist.
No doubt.
And so I think they've kind of redefined their role, and the model they've created is one that's being replicated around the world. People identify and appreciate, and they understand that this is a person that's self-directed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they believe in themselves, and mm-hmm. they're not worried about the institutions or anything else.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's part of maybe the answer I was looking for in asking you, how do we recast our image? Maybe there's a model already coming from our young people,
yes.
that takes up from the previous iterations of our existence, mm-hmm. and brings it into today. The technology that Ravi talked about means that we can communicate who we are more effectively, more quickly, more instantly. We can connect and build collaboration through Facebook and through Twitter and through other social media platforms, as well as our traditional legacy newspapers and radio resources as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that change is coming.
Yeah.
Let me ask you to close out, Leah, with how do people listening now get involved in the chamber if there are businesses that want to avail themselves of the service to become members? What do they need to do?
Well, we have a website, mm-hmm. And they could go on the website. There's an application. It's just a simple form that needs to be completed.
Mm-hmm.
There is no review that we make. I mean, we don't vet through it and say no, that yes to some and no to others. Membership is open to anyone, whether you are in business today or you aspire to be in business, whether you're a student or you're a professional. You can join the Chamber of Commerce. Whether you're of African descent or not, you can join the Chamber. In addition to that, we also have a Facebook page. So if they look for us on Facebook, they'll also get more information about how to join the organization, and they get engaged and involved.
Okay, great. Leah, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Leah Hargett, President and CEO of Minnesota Black Chamber of Commerce. Thank you for the work that you do.
Thank you.
Continued success. Thank you for watching and listening to Conversations with Al McFarlane. I'm your host, Al McFarlane.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to keep it right. Here. We just gonna